In the name of the Lord. O come, let us sing to the Lord. Let us heartily rejoice in the rock of our salvation. Let us come into his presence with thanksgiving and be glad in him with psalms and songs of praise. Let us open our hearts to worship in spirit and in truth, so that all we do may be pleasing to the Lord our God. In the name of his dear Son, Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen.
Thank you. kingdom.
And blessed be his kingdom, now and forever.
Amen.
Alleluia.
Alleluia.
Blessed Lord, Lord and Father,
we have assembled in your name and in fellowship with one another.
Enable us by your grace, all the sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving,
to proclaim and respond to your holy word.
Teach us to pray for your word and your church.
Grant that we, confessing our sins, may worthy of to you our souls and bodies as a living sacrifice,
and eat and drink of your spiritual food in this holy sacrament.
Amen.
A reading from the Word of God, written in Nehemiah chapter 2, reading from verse 1 through to 8. In the month of Nisan, in the 20th year of the king of Artaxerxes, when wine was served to him, I carried the wine and gave it to the king. Now, I had never been sad in his presence before. So the king said to me, "Why is your face sad, since you are not sick? This can only be sadness of the heart." Then I was very much afraid. I said to the king, "May the king live forever. Why should my face not be sad when the city, the place of my ancestors' graves, lies waste and its gates have been destroyed by fire?" Then the king said to me, "What do you request So I prayed to the God of heaven. Then I said to the king, if it pleases the king, and if your servant has found favor with you, I ask that you send me to Judah, to the city of my ancestors, graves, so that I may rebuild it. The king said to me, the queen also sitting beside him, how long will you be gone, and when will you return? So it pleased the king to send me, and I set him a date. Then I said to the king, if it pleases the king, let the letters be given me to the governors of the province beyond the river, that they may grant me passage until I arrive in Judah. And a letter of Asaph, the keeper of king's forest, directing him to give me timber to make beams for the gates of the temple fortress, and for the wall of the city, and for the house that I shall occupy. And the king granted me what I asked, for the gracious hand of my God was upon me. The word of the Lord.
Reading from Galatians 6, verses 14 to 18. May I never boast of anything except the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ, by which the world has been crucified to me, and I to the world. For neither circumcision nor uncircumcision is anything, but a new creation is everything. As for those who will follow this rule, peace be unto them and mercy, and upon the Israel of God. From now on, let no one make trouble for me, for I carry the marks of Jesus branded on my body. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with your spirit, brothers and sisters. Amen. The word of the Lord.
Thank you. Lord be with you.
And also with you.
A reading from the Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to Matthew.
Glory to Christ, our Savior.
At that time, Jesus said, I thank you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth, because you have hidden these things from the wise and the intelligent and have revealed them to infants. You, Father, for such as your gracious will, All things have been handed over to me, to my Father. But all things have been handed over to me by my Father, and no one knows the Son except the Father, and no one knows the Father except the Son, and anyone to whom the Son chooses to reveal him. Come to me, all you that are weary and carrying heavy burdens, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. The Gospel of Christ.
Praise to Christ our
Let us pray. God, uphold me that I may acclaim you. May the words of my mouth, the meditation of my heart, be now and always acceptable in your sight. As I speak in your name, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. The moment I knew I was to preach this afternoon, I began to pray and think about what I could and should reflect on. And so the matter of prayer came to me as a subject for reflection. And so I thought I would reflect on the theme of prayer, and in particular, pray as Jesus taught us. Pray as Jesus taught us. Now, when we think about that, of course, what comes to mind is the invitation of the disciples requesting that Jesus instruct them in the mechanics of prayer, how to pray. But more than that, and in the gospel reading for today, in St. Matthew chapter 11, verse 25 through to 30. But all of chapter 11, which I would encourage you to reflect on and read when you get a chance, all of chapter 11 really gives a sense of Jesus at prayer. The gospel reading for today's service begins with a spontaneous prayer of Jesus, but it is set within the context of a bigger narrative concerning how Jesus' prayer life works. So Matthew is reflecting on the life and work and ministry of Jesus in the first century at a very challenging and difficult time in the life of the church. Christians were being persecuted, and within the particular context that Matthew is writing, he's writing presumably to Jews who became Christians or followers of Jesus. And it seems, at least one view, is that some of them were beginning to get disillusioned. And so the pastor, Matthew, you could call him, is attempting to encourage the faithful. He's attempting to inspire them to persist and persevere in faith. So he uses John the Baptist as a person who exemplifies someone who looked to Jesus, but in a moment of doubt raises questions in his mind. Is Jesus really the Messiah? And so we are told that John sent messengers to Jesus asking the question, are you the one to come, or should we expect another? And one view is that John is raising this question because he's not seeing the kind of radical things that he himself practiced, but also that the Messiah is known for, riding on a horse, conquering people, and ultimately to overthrow the Roman leadership of the time. And so John is beginning to get disillusioned in prison, so he sent his followers, his disciples, to Jesus. Jesus did not answer directly to say whether or not he was the Messiah. He simply said to John's followers, look at what I am doing, and go back and tell John. The blind receive their sight, the lame walk, lepers are cleansed, and the poor have good news preached to them. And then we are told that after the disciples, John's disciples left, Jesus then challenged those present with the question, what did you really go out to the desert to see? What were you looking for? What is it that you were paying attention to? What were you anticipating? And so Jesus goes on to challenge the cities of Tyre and Sidon. One of these cities in today's Syria, and the other in Judea. To suggest that for Matthew, using the lens of the life of Jesus, Jesus is Messiah, Jesus is Lord, for both the Gentile and the Jewish community. And the work, the liberating work of the Messiah, is therefore not confined to the Jewish people, which is how people like John and others read the prophets. They read the prophets, in a sense, narrowly, as specifically confined to the Jewish nation. But we know from Isaiah, for example, that the Messiah is to be a light to the nations. Israel, of course, is not to be excluded. The Messiah is to be a light to the nations and the glory of the people of Israel. So Jesus places himself within the line of messiahship. He is liberator. He comes to free people. He comes to transform life, transform reality. Yes, in the way that John perceives it, a radical way, but also, as we will see, in a kind of mustard seed way, which is to permeate reality with the life of God, with the movement of God, with the activity of God, in ways that sometimes we do not notice. But it's a work, nonetheless, that is at work. It's a work that is transforming people's lives, as in the case of the blind receiving their sight, the deaf hear, and so on. And as I talk about the deaf hearing, I remember a story. Well, not a story, it's a true experience. When I was in the Brownstone cure, I was a young priest then, just visiting people. So I went to visit this elderly lady. She was over 100 years old at the time. So when I got to the home, the family said to me, "Boy, Father, we don't know if this visit makes sense, you know, because she's not hearing." I said, "It's okay, you know. I can do the prayers, you know," and she was a praying woman all her life, so it's okay. And nonetheless, the church also prays with her, and I'm here to offer those prayers. So I went in and greeted the lady. She didn't respond. And then I started with the collect for purity. And the lady started to pray, using the old version of the prayer. And from that collect for purity to the end of the communion service, the lady was praying. And it dawned on me that I should use some of those old responses from the readings from St. John chapter 3, verse 16, and so on, from the old prayer book, and she was in step with me. But you know, when the lady responded, when I began with the collect for purity, I looked around at the members of the family gathered, and they all looked at me shocked, because they all were in concert that the lady couldn't hear. And so I thought to myself, can you imagine all the things that she was hearing while there were... So when we talk about Jesus healing, it's not so much the dramatic healing that we think about, because I think about healing in the context of this woman, not in the way we think about it, but she was there, but clearly a woman of God, deep in her spirituality. But clearly they were in a different place, probably very noisy and boisterous in the house, and she wanted her space of quiet for contemplation. And so she pretended to be deaf so that she could be alone with God in the midst of the noise. No, that's not what Matthew means by saying the deaf receive the hearing. But nonetheless, it suggests a way of gaining insight into the reality of life. And one of the ways we get that insight is through prayer. And so in the Message version of the Bible, the verse 25 of Matthew chapter 11 begins, Jesus broke out into spontaneous prayer. And I like that translation because it says that Jesus prayed from his heart. He prayed from the depth of his own being. The words came out spontaneously, but nonetheless reflected the reality of Jesus' relationship with his Father. And while prayer is personal, as we will see in a little while, prayer is also communal. That is, it's not just something we do by ourselves and to ourselves. It is something that we do together. It is something that we do in a community. And it seems to me that in that latter sense, it's natural that Matthew has Jesus moving from that spontaneous communication with God through prayer to challenging the disciples and those who were listening, to suggest to them that prayer is not just communicating one-on-one with God, it is also engaging in acts of justice. So in that chapter 11 of Matthew's gospel, Jesus is condemning the people of Tyre and the people of Sidon, suggesting to them that the way they are living, concentrating on themselves, concentrating on the things that they accumulate rather than on God, that their own condemnation, their own judgment, is evolving as a consequence of their immersion in this materialist way of perceiving reality and living. And so it is that Jesus encourages those who would want to live differently, who recognizes him as Messiah, to come to him. Again, in the Message version, he says, "Come to me, all you who are weary of traditional religion, carrying heavy burdens, come and I will give you rest." And it is in that spirit, sisters and brothers, that I invite us to pray as Jesus taught us. Hopefully with the recognition that prayer is not just something that we do to ourselves and by ourselves, although that is important, but also to recognize and embrace the discipline of prayer as something that is about community and how we engage community, how we engage in acts of social justice. So let's look at the first aspect of prayer, which is the individual aspect. Thomas Keating, a well-known spiritual writer and monk, gives a very simple definition of prayer. He says prayer is relationship with God. Prayer is relationship with God. And he says once we understand that, then everything else in life flows from this relationship. Sleeping, working, walking, talking, recreation, everything else flows as a consequence of this relationship with God. In fact, Keating says that when that relationship is deepened and enriched, very often like lovers, this commitment to prayer does not require words. So he says that very often in the monastery, he would sit for hours, especially towards the end of his life. He would just sit for hours, not saying anything, but recognize in the words of St. Paul that it's not just us who pray at that point, but it's the Spirit of God praying in and through us. So individual prayer, personal prayer, is about relationship with God. It's about deepening our commitment to God. It's about taking seriously praying as Jesus taught us. Praying with our eyes fixed on Jesus. Praying with the recognition that our lover, God, is always with us, always present. And so in that regard, we don't even have to shout when we pray. As one bishop always said, God is not deaf, so we don't need to shout. But you find, too, that the more that we go deeper in prayer, as Thomas Keating says, sometimes we don't need words. So to pray as Jesus taught us is to embrace prayer not just as something we do in terms of sitting or standing, as the case may be, but prayer becomes a way of life for us. In walking, in talking, in eating and sleeping, we are praying. But a second thing to note about prayer is its communal nature. Prayer is also corporate. And that individual dimension of prayer and discipline flow into corporate prayer. It's not lost on me, and I had to go through the prayers of intercession in the Book of Common Prayer to verify this. 7 times in the prayers of intercession, from prayer B through to prayer G, the word justice is used 7 times. And the word injustice is used once. Now, if you take the 7, what that to be the presence of God in the world, then we have to become the way of the Messiah, which is the blind see, the deaf hear, the lame walk. In doing so, we are putting justice into practice. And as is often said, there can be no peace if there's no justice. So the word peace is also used in the prayers of intercession, but not as often as justice. Which is to say that the more we engage in acts of justice, is the more peace will be realized in our midst. So how then can we conclude with this theme of praying as Jesus taught us? But I want to conclude with some words and insights from Claire, who is a mentor or mentee of St. Francis of Assisi. Claire has a way of framing the discipline of prayer. So she says, when we come to pray, we should look at Jesus. We should gaze upon Jesus. We should contemplate Jesus. We should listen to Jesus. And you know what I notice about that? She doesn't say we should talk to Jesus or talk with Jesus. And it's not that talking isn't important. But I suspect she's well aware of a well-known saying of Francis, preach the gospel, and if necessary, use words. And I suspect Claire is doing the same thing with respect to prayer. Pray, and if necessary, use words. So I invite us then to pray as Jesus taught us. To pray by spending time in relationship with Jesus and in personal prayer. But as we rise from our knees and our individual and personal spaces, let us also pray as an act of social justice to engage people in the community and to work with them to transform the lives, especially of those who are vulnerable and poor. And I close, as I mentioned at the beginning, with this story. Be careful what you say when you're around people. You never know who may be listening. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
for the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, all that is seen or unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten not made, one in being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he was born of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered, died, and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in fulfillment of the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again, perhaps giving every day. That kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one Lord, Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead, the life of the world to come. Amen.
Inspired by the Spirit of God, we make our prayers to the Father through Jesus Christ, blessed Savior and Redeemer, Church in the province of the West Indies, and all with whom we share a common baptism. May we all be faithful to the God. Sustaining God, we pray for your servants Garth and Leroy, that they may be strengthened and sustained by the gifts of your grace as they serve the church in this place and the wider diocese. We pray you will bless their families and those who uphold them as they continually refresh your people. We pray that the prayers of the people may encourage and inspire them in their lives and ministries. Sustaining God. Faithful God, we pray for Howard, our Archbishop, Leon and Garth, Bishops Suffragan, Justin, Patrick, and Leroy, Archdeacons, all canons of the Cathedral Chapter, all priests, deacons, and all other church workers. We pray that they will continue to inspire us with the joy of the gospel. May their ministries be furnished with wisdom and insight, compassion and love, and may they hold before us the pattern of our calling, Jesus Christ, the Good Shepherd. Faithful God, caring God, we pray for the world in all its pain and beauty, for those who have been scarred by the trauma of violence and oppression, for those whose minds and bodies ache because of afflictions, for those who have been suffering as a result of violent acts in their homes, communities, schools, and nations. Caring God, God of peace, we pray for those who risk their lives for the sake of peace and reconciliation, for those whose mission it is to construct bridges of trust and friendship among diverse cultures and faith traditions, for those who advocate and encourage us to listen to the voices of the outsider, the poor, and the persecuted, for those who work to foster healing wherever division and indifference seek to destroy hope for the future. God of peace, healing God, we pray for those absent from our midst today, but whose prayers are with us. We pray for those whose lives have been interrupted by illness, for those who care for them, for those who have no employment, and those who live in fear for the future. May they be empowered by your Spirit to journey on in faith and hope. Healing God. For Francis of Assisi, the Apostle James, and all the saints who have served you here and are now at rest, may we, with them, draw near to you for sustenance, grace, and support as we work with you for the greater good of your reign among us. God of all the saints in light, we commend ourselves, one another, and all the peoples of the earth to your mercy and love. Mercifully accept the prayers of your people and strengthen us to do your will. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Most Reverend Father in God, I present unto you the Venerable Leroy Antonia Johnson and request your grace as Dean of the Cathedral to install him as a member of the Cathedral Chapter in succession to the Venerable Winston Thomas, St. Dunstan.
I, Venerable Leroy Antonia Johnson, having been duly appointed an Archdeacon of this Cathedral Church of the Diocese of Jamaica and the Cayman Islands, and therefore an ex officio member of the Cathedral Chapter, do hereby promise that I will duly observe the statutes, rules, and customs of this Cathedral Church, and will defend its rights and privileges as far as in me lies.
Diocese of Jamaica and the Cayman Islands. Howard, by divine permission, Lord Bishop of Jamaica and the Cayman Islands. To our beloved in Christ, Leroy Antonio Johnson, greeting. Whereas the office of Archdeacon of Mandeville in the Diocese of Jamaica and the Cayman Islands became vacant by the retirement of the Venerable Winston Michael Thomas on the 30th day of June, 2021, and it is desirable that the said office should be filled. Now therefore, Howard, the Bishop of Jamaica and the Cayman Islands aforesaid, by virtue of our episcopal rights and in accordance with the canons of the Church in Jamaica and the Cayman Islands, in the province of the West Indies, having full confidence in your devotion, discretion, and fidelity, do appoint you, the Venerable Leroy Antonio Johnson, to be Archdeacon of the Mandeville region during our will and pleasure, and to exercise authority in the Mandeville region aforesaid in this Diocese of Jamaica and the Cayman Islands to aid us in administering the ecclesiastical affairs of the said archdeaconry in such manner as the canons of the Church in Jamaica and the Cayman Islands in the province of the West Indies do provide and as we expect. And further, we, by these presents, recognize and admit you as a member ex officio of the Cathedral Chapter, possessing the rights of a canon of the Cathedral Church of the St. Jago-de-la-Vega in this our Diocese of Jamaica and the Cayman Islands. Signed, Peter DePass, Registrar, and Howard K. A. Gregory, Archbishop of the West Indies, Bishop of Jamaica, and the Cayman Islands.
in pursuance of the intentions and in accordance with the provisions of the canon of the Cathedral Chapter, adopted by the Synod of the Diocese of Jamaica on the 13th day of February 1899, and subsequently amended, we, Howard Kingsley Ainsworth Gregory, by divine permission, Archbishop of the West Indies, Primate and Metropolitan, and Lord Bishop of Jamaica and the Cayman Islands, and Dean of this Cathedral, do by these present admit you, the Venerable Leroy Antonio Johnson, as a member of the chapter of the said Cathedral Church in this Diocese of Jamaica and the Cayman Islands. In testimony whereof, we have hereunto set our hand and affixed our seal this fourth day of October in the year of our Lord 2022. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let us pray. Almighty God, the giver of all good gifts, in your divine providence, you have appointed various orders in your church. Give your grace, we humbly pray, to all who are now called to any office and ministry for your people. And so fill them with the truth of your doctrine and clothe them with holiness of life, that they may faithfully serve before you to the glory of your great name and for the benefit of your holy church. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Almighty and everlasting God, by your Spirit, the whole body of your faithful people is governed and sanctified. Receive our prayers, which we offer before you for all members of your holy church, that in their vocation and ministry, they may truly serve you, through our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, best preserve and keep you. The Lord be with you in your going out and your coming in, and enable you to fulfill the ministry which you have received.
Most Reverend Father in God, I present you the Right Reverend Garth Alverton Minott and request your grace as Dean of the Cathedral to install him in the Suffragan Chair of Kingston in his new office as Suffragan Bishop of Kingston in succession to the Right Reverend Robert Thompson.
Bishop for the Suffragan See of Kingston, and therefore a member of the chapter of this cathedral church, in virtue of my office as dean of this cathedral, and recognizing him as a member of the cathedral chapter, I now proceed to install him in the Suffragan chair made vacant by the retirement of the Right Reverend.
Diocese of Jamaica and the Cayman Islands, instrument of admission and installation of a member of the chapter of the Cathedral of St. Jago-de-la-Vega in Spanish Town. Howard, by divine permission, Lord Bishop of Jamaica and the Cayman Islands, to the Right Reverend Garth Alverton Minott, by divine permission, Bishop of Kingston, Jamaica. Whereas, in accordance with the provisions of the Constitution and canons of the Church in Jamaica and the Cayman Islands, in the province of the West Indies, by virtue of your office as Suffragan Bishop of Kingston, you are now a member of the Cathedral Chapter of this diocese. And whereas you have taken and subscribed to the required oaths of office, we do, by these presents, now admit and install you, the said Garth Alverton Minott, as a member of the Chapter of the Cathedral of St. Jago-de-la-Vega in the Diocese of Jamaica and the Cayman Islands. In testimony whereof, we have hereunto set our hand and seal this fourth day of October in the year of our Lord 2022 and in the 20th year of our consecration. Signed, Registrar Peter DePass and Howard K.A. Gregory, Archbishop of the West Indies, Bishop of Jamaica and the Cayman Islands.
May the Lord stir up in you the flame of the holy charity and the power of faith that overcome the world.
Amen.
Where charity and love are found, God is there. The love of Christ has gathered us together. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Peace of the Lord.
Through your goodness, Lord, we have this bread and wine to offer, this money with which you have blessed us. Fruit of the earth and the work of human hands, they'll become our spiritual food.
All things come from you, O Lord, and of your own do we give you, the blessing of God forever. Amen.
The Lord be with you. Sent forth his apostles to preach the gospel and to teach all nations, and promised to be with them always, even to the end of the ages. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn, to proclaim the glory of your because in your loving wisdom, you brought all things into being and are truly worthy of praise from every creature you have made. Again and again, we've turned away from you, yet in every age, your steadfast love has called us to return, to live in union with you. For it is your eternal purpose to put new life into all things and make them holy. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, who took our human nature upon him, you have redeemed the world from the bondage of sin, and by the power of your Holy Spirit, you have gathered a people to yourself to make known in every place his perfect offering which he made to the glory of your name. Hear us, therefore, Father, through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, and grant that these gifts of bread and wine may be unto us his body and blood. For on the night that he was betrayed, he took bread. When he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take this and eat it. This is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." And after supper, he took the cup of wine. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me."
Let us proclaim the mystery of our faith.
Rejoicing in his holy incarnation, his blessed passion, and his perfect sacrifice made once for all upon the cross, his mighty resurrection from the dead, his glorious ascension into heaven, and looking for his coming in glory, we offer you this bread and this cup. We pray that you will accept this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, and grant that all who eat and drink of the body and blood of your Son, our great High Priest, may be renewed by your Holy Spirit and be one body, one spirit in him. Let faith and love increase in us. Unite us with all bishops, all of the ministers of your word and sacraments, and with the whole people of God, living and departed, whom you have made for yourself. Confirm us in holiness, that we may be found ready to join the company of the Blessed Virgin Mary, the holy apostles, and all your saints, when our Lord Jesus Christ comes again, forever giving you thanks and praise through him, from whom all good things do come. With him and in him and through him, by the power of the Holy Spirit, we worship you, Father Almighty, with all who stand before you in earth and heaven, in songs of everlasting praise.
gifts of God for the people of God.
Our souls to feast and be satisfied, and we will sing that songs of praise to Him.
Thank you. I'm asking persons who have parked on the compound of the library to move your vehicles from that compound to this immediately. The library is about to be closed.
Heavenly Father, we thank you for feeding us with the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Send us now into the world in peace and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you and all persons in you with gladness of heart. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Our help is in the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Almighty God, who for the salvation of humankind gives to his people many gifts and ministries for the advancement of his kingdom, stir up in you the gifts of his grace, sustain each one of you in your own ministries, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be amongst you and remain with you this day and always.
When I am down and oh my soul so weary, when troubles come and my heart burdened be, then I am still and wait here in the silence until you come and sit a while with me. You raise me up so I can stand on mountains. You raise me up to walk on stormy seas. I am strong when I am on your shoulder. You raise me up to more than I can be. There is no life when thou near its hunger, each restless heart beats so imperfectly. But when you come and I am filled with wonder, sometimes I think I glimpse eternity. You raise me up so I can stand on mountains. You raise me up to walk on stormy seas. I am strong when I am on your shoulder. You raise me up to more than I can be. Stormy seas, I am strong. I can be. You raise me up so I can stand on mountains. You raise me up the more that I can be.
Good afternoon to my brothers and sisters. I first want to express an apology for the Right Reverend Robert Thompson, who would have been here, save that he had a prior engagement that he must keep. But I know that he is here with us in spirit. This is a wonderful celebration. We are joyful for the church. We give God thanks for calling us and entrusting to us, his church. I want to extend on behalf of Your Grace congratulations to Bishop Garth and the Venerable Leroy. We continue to support them in our prayers and otherwise as they take on additional responsibilities to carry forward the ministry to which they have been called and sent. I want to acknowledge the presence among us of the Chancellor, Justice the Honorable Mrs. Zayla McCullough, who has always been with us on occasions like this. There are certain special duties that she must perform on these occasions, and she carries them out well. Along with the Bishop of Montego Bay, the retired bishops, Well, we had Bishop. Bishop Daniel is the only one present. Members of the clergy. From far and wide, throughout the whole diocese, we were a little surprised to see the number. But we come to support our brothers in their ministry. Members of the Cathedral Chapter present in their number. And even as I speak of the chapter members, our next gathering here will be on Cathedral Sunday. And you'll be informed about that in short order. We want to welcome the spouses of the clergy as you support them in their work. Particularly, I want to say a special welcome to the family and friends of Bishop Garth and Archdeacon Leroy. I was told that this is an international gathering of their families, from Portland in the east to Westmoreland in the west, from Clarendon in the south, to Retreat in the north, and from Jamaica to the United Kingdom. Welcome to you all. This is an occasion for celebration. We want to say thanks to the members of the Diocesan Festival Choir. Under the direction of Mr. Audley Davidson, who is also the choir master. And complementing the musical offering, Miss Carol Reed and her accompanists. Miss Margie Wiley and Dr. Joycelyn Barton on the drums. You know, today as we come on this occasion, we cannot but single out a few persons individually. The mother of Bishop Garth, Denise, Bishop Garth's spouse, we can't do everyone, Mr. Clovis and Mrs. Camilla Johnson, father and mother of Archdeacon Leroy. Along with them are other members of their families, supporting your sons. Very important. I want to acknowledge members of the Church House staff, members of United Theological College of the West Indies, and other associates of Bishop Garth and Archdeacon Leroy, who have come supporting him. Thank you very much for your presence and participation. The Chairman of the Diocesan Financial Board, members of Council, members of the Diocesan organizations, that's the BSA, Mothers Union, Women's Auxiliary, and others. I must say thanks to all those who assisted to make this service what it is. It's a lot of work. But I want to recognize Miss Rena Williams, who you don't often see up front. Miss Rena, where are you? The tech team. The MCs, making sure that everything flows smoothly. The ushers from the cathedral and those who prepare the place, the flowers, and otherwise. I want to say a special thanks to a little one, Isabel Gordon. Isabel is shy, so she wouldn't even want to stand. Right, Isabel? You want to stand? Please stand, Isabel. She's a student at St. Jago High. That's not what I want to talk about. But Isabel called me two nights ago to find out, as she inquired, about duties as a server, whether or not she's needed. And I assured her that every service that is held here requires servers. And although today is a school day, Isabel is present. Thank you, Isabel. And I'm doing this because I want the others to get jealous, you see? But I really thank you, and it says something about you, Isabel. I had admitted to say thanks for the presence of Archbishop Kenneth Richards, who was with us but had to leave at one point. Archbishop Richards from the Archdiocese of Kingston. He's also the president of the Jamaica Council of Churches. Come to share with us, and we really appreciate that. For anyone who I have omitted acknowledging and saying thanks to you. All you who have come worshiping together, I notice we have from the Salvation Army one of our colleagues. We are indeed happy to have you with us, sir. Some of us will need to travel far, and so it's important that we get going. Let me trust that you will travel safely and that you will be reunited with your family, your families, in peace and in safety tonight. Pray for Garth. Pray for Leroy. Pray for the church. God go with you all. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Go in peace and serve the Lord.